I'm very pleased to be here today talking with Jonathan Tropper about his new novel. One last thing before I go. Jonathan, thank you for coming to talk to us today.
Thank you for having me. I'm glad to be here.
So tell me a little bit about this novel. This is your sixth novel.
Yes.
And I've read some of your earlier books, and I think this one was different for me. It had a gravity to it that's different from some of your earlier books. So how did you arrive at the subject here and this particular character?
Yeah, the gravity kind of took me by surprise. I generally set out, to write novels that are, that do deal with pretty heavy issues, generally death and relationships, family dynamics, but I do try to do it in a lighthearted way, and that was my intention when I started writing this book. But gradually, as I got into the head of this character who really had so much regret in his life and so many things so many mistakes that he could not correct, I had never really written about someone who's so past the point of redemption. Most of my characters, things go terribly wrong, but the book is about them correcting that. And this guy, we were meeting him at a later point in his life where those mistakes had been made years ago, and he couldn't correct them. And I guess once I got into his head, I started feeling that kind of regret, and so it became a deeper and more textured study of this kind of character. So, while there's still a lot of comedy in the book, his journey is definitely a darker journey, and I think that's what imbues the book with a little more gravity than the others.
Yeah, and it's a very interesting portrait of a man sort of at that midlife point who's very, he's very honest with himself and honest about how he's feeling and where he's at, and I think it makes him very real in spite of the fact that, the sort of the burden of his past and his choices weighs so heavily upon him. I think that he stands up to it in a way that I think makes the novel very interesting.
One of the things that I found appealing about writing this character of Silver is that he's reached a point where he doesn't even have pretensions anymore. It's so clear if you just look at him. This crappy apartment he lives in, the fact that he was once something of a rock star, and now he plays in a third-rate wedding band, the fact that he's estranged from his daughter, he's estranged from his ex-wife, he's lost touch with his family even. He really has nothing, and when you reach that point, there's no longer any denial, there's no longer any posing and trying to seem like you have more than you have. He's one of the lonely people, that's who he is, and that's how he identifies himself. So there's no delusions.
And how do you when we meet him at that point where he's just sort of at the baseline? He has in fact a life or death decision before him, and he goes against the grain. Did you see that happening with him? I mean, is that his?
Yeah, that was always the plan of the book was. It's always just assumed, that you're going to fight for your life. Whether it's cancer, whether it's a heart defect, whether it's a bullet, whatever it is, that no matter what's going on in your life, you're going to just fight to keep living, which to me is a very human trait. And it's both an instinct, and it has to do, I think, with hope that, we all, no matter what's going on in our lives, we all believe our lives are worth living. And I wanted to deal with a guy who actually may not believe that. And none of his family and none of his friends can believe that he really doesn't believe that. But here's a guy who really isn't sure he wants to save his own life. And the idea that he makes this decision not to have the life-saving operation and nobody else can understand it, but we're in his head and we do understand that he might be ready to check out now rather than continue living this empty life.
And what do you think about that? I mean, is it brave to you, or is it...
I don't think
desperate.
I don't think it's brave, because the brave thing is to, to keep going and to try to fix your life and try to do better. To me, I think what it is he's giving himself a deadline. He's saying, these are the things I've done wrong. These are the things I need to be better at. And if I die before I get them done, then I don't deserve to live. And if I get them done, then maybe I'll consider the operation. But he's basically saying, this is my wake-up call, and I'm going to look death in the eye while I try to fix these things.
How do you kind of process how that decision impacts the people around him, the people that he feels sort of adrift from, that he's people he's failed in his life, his wife and his daughter. Like, that decision kind of lights a fire under them in a unique way.
Yeah, I mean, and that's the whole thing, is no matter how estranged you are from somebody, we all kind of throw all of our personal issues aside when it gets to life and death. I mean, there's very few family members who won't show up for you in a time of crisis, regardless of what you've been through. So they do show up for him because they feel connected to him, but they're also deeply frustrated by his behavior over the last 7 years, and now his refusal to sort of save his own life. And,
right.
And so it's this weird tension that exists in this family where they've all come together to try to help him, but he's not interested in being helped. And,
right.
And they're not really interested in being there. It's just, it's this weird dynamic where they're all sort of thrown together by this, you know, this sort of radical decision he's made to not save his life.
Right. And to me, I mean, at certain points, and I think some of the humor of the story helps, you know, drive this home for me, and that he's on this weird sort of George Bailey trip. Like, he's not George Bailey, but he's in that crisis of, you know, what
it's
if funny,
I wasn't you're the
here.
Second person who said George
oh,
Bailey
really?
To me, and it never occurred to me.
I mean, he's not.
That's funny.
I mean, it's sort of a slant connection, right? Because he's not that guy. But in certain moments, and certainly in the desperation of that, he's staring down the barrel of it. But the way that you treat his journey is really clever, and I think that it raises him up from where we first meet him. And, you know, when I started reading it, I was like, oh my goodness, like, how is he going to come out of this? And he really does have an interesting path.
Well, there's an honesty to him that I enjoyed writing, that, you know, he's like I said before, he's reached this point where, you know, we all lie to ourselves. We all tell ourselves, if I can just do this, things will get better. If I can just do that, things will get better. And he's just past the point of lying to himself.
Right.
And he's just, he knows this is what his life is. And then as he starts having these mini strokes because of his heart situation, that forces him to be not just honest with himself, but honest with other people. And it creates this dynamic where this is what happens when we actually tell the truth to each other, which we don't generally do. So I was interested in that.
What do you think he was like, you know, at 24? Like, where did he go wrong? Like,
well, I think where he went wrong in this particular case was, you know, he was a drummer, he was a rock star, and he tasted fame. I mean, his band had this one hit that made them superstars, and then the whole thing fell apart really quickly, and once you've been there, nothing else seems good enough again, and he just always believed he was going to get back there, but of course he never did, and so his whole regular life, where he had so many things to appreciate, he just stopped appreciating them because he had once been a rock god, and he never recovered from that.
It's like the thing that he can't let go of.
Yeah, and it's just like, yeah, he lost the ability to appreciate things like a wife and a daughter and a family, and it was all about being a superstar, and he was a superstar so briefly, it was just like 1 second, but that 1 second colored everything afterwards.
How do you think that male readers will react to Drew and sort of the way that he
I think they'll appreciate
drops the reins?
I think they'll appreciate some of the stuff he says. I mean, he's really sort of, I was uncomfortable writing some of the stuff he says. I mean, he says the stuff many men sometimes think without saying it, and, you know, the way he assesses those college girls who hang out at the swimming pool, the way he assesses his own sexuality, the way he assesses his place on the dating food chain. Mm-hmm. And, you know, he's brutally honest with himself, but he's also brutally honest about the women and about the people around him. And there's something really fun about being with somebody who has no filter. And
right.
He has absolutely no filter.
So I just wanted to switch topic just quickly. You've done some writing for TV and film, and you're developing a new series.
Yeah, we're shooting it, actually. It's developed.
It's developed.
We're shooting it,
yeah. So tell me a little bit more about that.
Our television show is for HBO Cinemax. It's called Banshee, and it's very different from my books. It's a 1 hour drama, very much in the spirit of David Cronenberg or the Coen brothers. Involves, you know, a lot of violence, a lot of sexuality, gangsters, that kind of thing, set in modern day Pennsylvania. And that's something we're shooting 10 episodes now for Cinemax, produced by HBO, and it's just using a different muscle.
Mm-hmm.
It's a lot of fun. And I recently finished adapting my last book, This Is Where I Leave You, for Warner Brothers, and that's actually scheduled to start shooting this September. in New York, and I'm very excited about that.
How was that experience writing for screen versus the page?
Like, it's just a different, like I said, it's a way to diversify your mind creatively. Right. It's a very different kind of writing. This book, one last thing before I go, has just been optioned by Paramount, and I'll be writing the screenplay for that as well. And it's a way to kind of take the story you've written as a novel and tell a new story on film. It's it's different, and it's just it's if you just sit and write prose all day, at least I'll burn out from that. So it's fun to be able to put that aside and then open up final draft and start writing scenes. Yeah.
Do you get to write more female characters, like when you're working in this new show, or?
We have a really strong female lead, and my books do tend to generally have a male protagonist, only because that's what comes naturally.
Right.
But I do try to spend a lot of time on the female characters in the book and make sure that they're real humans and not just there to be the female character. And
right.
You know, I've been told sometimes I've been really successful at it, and I've been told sometimes I haven't been, and, you know, you just keep trying.
Right, 6 of 1. Some people get it, some people don't, so you just keep going.
Right.
Well, thank you for being here today. It was really good to talk to you.
Thank you for having me.